I want that for you too. Whatever success means to you, and you are free to define it however you'd like. I hope this book helps you find your way. Keep following the roadmap. Keep doing the work. Keep getting your message out there. And I'm confident you'll discover a life of deeper meaning and purpose. You'll become the communicator you were meant to be, a truly successful speaker. And the world will thank you for it. Now, go make your message matter. Hey, this is Grant Baldwin, and today we are going to be doing a little bonus material for the audiobook. Today we're going to be bringing in my friend and partner in crime on this project, Mr. Jeff Goins. So Jeff, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Good to be here. So what we're going to do here is I'm going to ask you some questions. We're going to talk about what it was like to write this book, some of the things that we did not include in the book that we're going to talk about here in this section, and even kind of update people on things that have changed in the speaking industry since we wrote this book over a year ago at the time of this recording. So some things have changed. So question one for you is, talk about how this book came about. How did we even get to write a book together?
This is largely all your fault that this came to this point. So how we got here was, you were hosting some type of mastermind meetup kind of luncheon thing that was literally about a block away from where we are currently recording this. And there's probably, I don't know, a handful of people there. You invited me to come and just do some Q&A about speaking and teaching the business of speaking, public speaking. And so we did that. It was fun. Had a great time. Didn't think anything of it. And then, so you texted me a little bit later that day and said, have you ever thought about writing a book? And my response was something to the effect of like, not really. I know a lot of people, it's a huge aspiration to write a book. I actually self-published a book several years ago. So from like a bucket list standpoint of wanting to write a book, just to say you wrote a book and make your mom proud, I checked that box a few years ago, so I felt good. But we kind of dialogued a little bit about it. And you said, hey, one of the guys that was at this Q&A thing is in the publishing space. He thought you'd do a great job with a book and he'd love to chat with you. Are you open to it? Sure, I'm happy to meet with whoever. So we go and I meet with him and kind of gets the wheels spinning. And so you and I continue the conversation and you said, hey, what if we, rather than you just doing this book on your own, what if I do it with you? And you and I have been friends for several years. I've known that you had a massive amount of experience in the publishing space. I know that you not only enjoy writing books, but you write very, very good books. And so all of a sudden the pieces started to come together to like, this is an absolute great idea. So we discussed what it would look like to work together and kind of evolved from there to we're standing here now recording this. It's pretty wild.
Yeah, and that was really fun. And you did a great job with the audio book. Well done. And for those who don't understand how this process works, I don't know that I understood it before we did it.
I didn't either until you proposed it.
Right. So Grant is the author. These are all his ideas that show up in all of his work, his podcast, his courses, trainings, etc. And my assistant, Liz Morrow, and I translated these ideas into a book. And we wrote the book in your voice through many interviews and conversations that you and I had and talking to clients that you've worked with and listening to old podcast interviews. It was super fun. What was it like to read your words, your ideas written by somebody else? Yeah.
One, it was very impressive how accurate it was. And so I know that some of it is taking some concepts and making them sound more articulate for a book. And some of them were some direct quotes that I know that I use and regularly use when teaching students. So from that standpoint, you guys did an amazing job of taking a lot of existing content. And even when we first discussed the project, it, like you mentioned, it's podcasts, interviews, it's courses, it's blog posts. It's a lot of stuff that's out there, a lot of content that's out there. But putting it together in a book format that's easy to read and easy to navigate for someone is a unique challenge. And so you guys did a phenomenal job with that and doing it again with taking my voice in mind and putting our words into the book.
Yeah. So somebody's at the end of the book. They're hopefully still listening. What do you hope that they do now? Like, what is the next step for the reader after they finish this book? What's a good next step?
Yeah. So as you well know, speaking is a very aspirational thing. So it's very much like writing a book where a lot of people do it. Not a lot of people will take action on it. So I think for people who will go through a book like this, who are probably more than just, hey, I'm kind of loosely interested in speaking. I literally just thought about speaking over the weekend and I picked up this book and I'm still kind of loosely interested in it. A lot of these people have probably been interested in speaking for months or years and are still kind of just kicking the tires of it. It would be fun to do someday. I don't know what to do. And so one of the things that we work together on really strategically is to give you every possible thing that you need to really demystify the speaking world so that at this point you have no more excuses. And so if anything, I really hope that people take action on what they have read or what they have listened to, and that it's more than just, that was cool, it made me feel good, it was interesting, it was fascinating, whatever. But ultimately, that they do something with it and that they take action on everything that we've covered within the book, because we have held nothing back. You have no excuses not to be doing something with what we've shared.
So if I'm just getting started speaking, I picked up this book because I want to become a successful professional public speaker, and I finished the book, like, what is the next step action that I can take to go from zero to one?
Yeah. And that, again, that's why at the end of each chapter, we have laid out that action plan of, here's your next steps. Here's the things that you need to be doing. And so some of it depends on kind of where you're at in the speaking journey. But for someone who is brand new, I'm loosely interested in speaking, I have little to no speaking experience, I want to do something, what's my next step? Go back through the book through S. Mm. Select a problem to solve. Because if you're not clear on who you speak to, what's the problem that you solve, then nothing else within the book really makes a difference. So go back to the beginning there and start to lay that foundation. One of the things we talked about in the book is the more clear you are on that first piece, then the rest of the steps become much, much simpler and much easier. It's counterintuitive, but again, if we feel like we can speak to anyone and everybody about anything, you really aren't going to make any progress with that. So the more clear you are from the beginning, the easier it is to actually make progress as a speaker. So getting started, day one, what do I do now? Go back to S, select a problem to solve, and do what we put in the book. Do the action items, take action on it, and begin to move the ball forward.
And I want to point out that you have a bonus resource. One of the things that you were really intentional about when we were working on the book was, let's not put a bunch of information in regards to technology, tools, resources, et cetera, that in a year or two are going to be outdated. Say this video editing software or this website building tool or whatever it might be. And so you created a whole list of resources that you're going to continue to update, that you point people to in and throughout the book, so that if somebody goes, okay, like, I need a new speaker reel, what are the best tools for me to put that together today? And they're reading this, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 years after the book has come out.
Right.
Talk about that list of resources. Where can people find it, just for those who are ready to start taking action, but they need a little bit more help?
Yeah, all of those additional bonus resources can be found at speakerbookbonus.com. We reference it throughout the book. But to your point, we started first talking about the book, you know, 2 years ago, first sort of really writing the book. At this time of recording, then we're, you know, 2 years later, and someone may be listening to this, you know, 2, 3, 10 years from now. And so there's a lot that can always evolve and change. And so because of that, we wanted to create a kind of a hub, a resource where people can continually come back to for years to come and get the most up-to-date technology, tools, resources that they need to be able to find and book speaking gigs. So even though we want the book to be a standalone thing that can live hopefully for years and years to come, we know that some of the tools and the methodology that may or some of the resources that may be used to implement some of the methodology may change and evolve over time. So definitely check out speakerbookbonus.com for the most up-to-date and best tools to be using.
So without listing a bunch of tools that are going to be outdated in 6 months, what are some things that have changed in the speaking industry since we started this book? Because as you said, you know, it was basically a 2-year process from idea to finished product. And that was something that we struggled with. On one hand, we wanted to provide lots of helpful, practical resources for people. You know, on the other hand, you didn't want to put down a bunch of stuff, information in a book that's going to be outdated in a few months. So since the writing of this book, what has changed? What are you seeing in the professional speaking industry that you can speak to, you know, in terms of what's working these days, understanding that things are always evolving?
Yeah, I'll give you two examples, especially from a technology and tool standpoint. One is going to be CRMs. That's one of the things we talked about in the book, but a customer relationship management tool is basically a way to continually reach out to follow up with potential clients and to stay top of mind with them. So before, it used to be maybe, you know, paper and pen, or just use kind of a calendar and kind of a makeshift thing, or do something via Excel or a Google Sheet or some type of spreadsheet. But today, there's a lot of different tools. So one of the tools that a lot of our students use is from HubSpot. It's a free CRM tool. that provides basically a kind of a central place where you can keep track of all of your potential clients, people that you're following up with. Because like we talked about the process, you may reach out to one person and they say, hey, follow up with me in 6 months. And someone else needs you to follow up with them in 2 months. And someone else needs you to follow up with them a week from now. And so it starts that there's a lot to keep track of. So having a really good tool to do that is really, really important. And so there's a lot more tools that are available today that weren't available a few years ago that can help make that process simpler. Another example in terms of just the evolution of tools would be for demo videos. So for example, I know for me years ago when I shot my first demo video, I literally borrowed like kind of a handy cam from a friend, like a standalone camera, because that's what they had. But today, some of the best cameras and video cameras are in our pockets that we all carry around on a daily basis in the form of our phones. And so you can use the technology that you have in terms of a video camera via your phone and create some really high quality footage that you wouldn't have been able to do, you know, a few years ago. And so that type of technology is not only great today, but it continually improves so that, you know, what we all carry around in our pockets maybe as good, if not better, than some of the off-the-shelf video cameras, standalone cameras that you could buy, you know, years from now. So that really makes the barrier to creating that demo video, it makes it a lot lower. So people are, you no longer have the excuse of like, well, I can't shoot video because I don't have a good camera. Well, you do. It's in your pocket. And so those are the type of things that you can continually use today to continue, again, to move the ball forward in your speaking business.